Start by praying for our nations and also for all the frontliners, even they are working very hard right now. Let's close our eyes and let us bow our heads. And for all the viewers, you can join us to close your eyes and bow your heads as well. Father, we thank you for the nations of Malaysia. As we lift up, Lord, this nation, we thank you, Lord, for your hand is upon this nation of God. And Lord, we thank you for all the prayers that have been offered to you. And Lord, and you are the God who hears, and you are the God who answers, O God. You are the God who stretch up your hands to protect and to deliver and to bless, O God. Father, we pray you continue to grant favor upon the nation of Malaysia. Continue to bless and protect Malaysia, O God, from this virus. Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy and grace upon our nation, Malaysia. And Father, even right now, we want to lift up all the frontliners, the doctors, the nurses, the paramedics, the medical staff, Lord, and everyone that is involved, for Father God. Lord, in the medical profession related to it as well, Lord, in helping the sick and the needy. And Lord, let your hand be upon them, O God, to protect them, Lord, as they treat the patients. And Lord, let your hand be upon them, O Father God, to renew their strength as well. And Father, we thank you, O Lord, for this nation. We thank you for all the frontliners. Lord, bless them, O Lord, and cover them with your precious blood of protections. And Father, in all these we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, church. Now let's get ready to hear the word of the Lord today. The Bible. If you have the Bible, please turn with me to John chapter 17, verse 3. John chapter 17, verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Before I proceed further, I just want to thank all of you. It was last week God put in my heart to start the FGCCI 3 days, 24-hour prayer chain for nations. And last week we have the prayer chain in all our FGCCI churches involving all our pastors and those who wants to team up with us as well. And they have established the 3-day, 24-hour prayer chain in Pakistan, in India, even in Sri Lanka. And in the Philippines as well, and here in Malaysia, the main church is involved, as well as Subang Church and our Tamil Church, even our Chinese church is coming up as well. And I just want to thank all of you for participating. It's just really a wonderful time, 3 days of consecration, and every one of you taking the time to sign up for the session, 1 hour session for 3 days. And Pastor was always looking forward in the different watches, because we divided into 4 watches. I always have to see which watch and who are the prayer partners, and I was looking for which time this session belongs to who. And I thank God I able to take the first session, and it was just a wonderful time, especially when on Tuesday night, 11 p.m. to 12 p.m., we have our last session, which is our 72 sessions. And I think it's Sister Grace Ong and Esther Belu, they were praying for the last session. It's like finishing a marathon, and so many of you were just tuning in to see the finishing, and it was just so wonderful. And after that, the Lord gave the Rhema word, you know, finding in Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17 to 19, which our scripture reader, but then Noel Edwin just read to us, especially, and also in Isaiah 59, verse 19, I believe. God, that the Lord will raise up a standard against this enemy, the virus, for Malaysia and for Philippines. And we are so thankful for all of you for joining in this prayer chain. And we'll continue to pray for those who are still having their prayer chain. And as the Lord leads, we are going to have another 3 days, 24-hour prayer chain for the nations in the coming days. And I, Pastor, will keep you informed as well. Just want to thank all of you for participating. Hallelujah. And let's go to the Word of God today. I also want to thank some of you who have called up and asked for the bank account, and you have banked in a tithe and an offering. So it's so encouraging, and the church is so blessed. Thank you all for doing that. For the covenanted, for being covenanted with the church and being so committed as well, being so faithful to give all to the Lord to advance His kingdom upon this earth. Thank you. And also many of our churches is helping the refugee community, because we have an FGCCI Refugee Community Center, and also many of our pastors are helping up the refugee community, especially the families, because most of them, the jobs have stopped because they are daily wage earner. Now everything stopped because of the movement control order. So we team up with many various ministry and NGO. Now we also want to thank all those NGO that we have teamed up, especially with the Food for Hope as well. We want to thank them for their support. And also for PJEFC for their reach out ministry to help the poor and the needy at this time. We want to thank them as well. And many others, we want to not able to mention them exactly the name, but we want to thank them for all their support. And we're able to give it to our families in Klang, in Kajang, in Sento, in KL, in Kepong, and all over. So I want to really thank all the pastors who are very, very hardworking in delivering all this food support to the families who are in need. Thank you, all of them. Hallelujah. In John chapter 17, verse 3, he says very clearly, what is eternal life? Eternal life is that we may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. We will continue to know God even when we are in heaven, because God is infinite. And it's such a joy to know Him. It's such a joy to walk with Him. It's such a joy to draw closer to Him. Many years ago, as I was meditating about how to draw closer to God and to share a message that will help younger Christian and the time I was just growing in the Lord to draw closer to God. And I just want to know how to draw closer to Him. And suddenly the Holy Spirit begins to give me this revelation of drawing closer to Him. And since the day I begin to use this revelation that the Lord has shown to me. And tonight, I'm so glad to be able to share it with you by the leading of the Lord. This is one of my favorite messages to help Christians to draw closer to God. And with this understanding, and I hope that you're able to draw closer to the Lord. And even for those who not know the Lord yet, as you listen to this message, I hope that you too were able to know Him and in time draw closer to Him. The title of my message today is The Hand of God, The Face of God, and The Heart of God. I say it again. The Hand of God, The Face of God, and The Heart of God. That's how you draw closer to God. Even in the natural, when we meet someone, normally you will stretch up your hands to each other and you begin to shake hands. And of course, at this time, people are requested not to shake hands and touch each other's hands because of the virus that can be transmitted. It's rather sad because shaking hands is a great sign of warm friendship, a great sign of extending love to each other. And even as you hear God's word today, I want you to know God is stretching forth His hands towards you to shake your hands. And it's up to you to stretch out your hands to shake the hand of God. And the first thing, to know God, first you have to know His hand. You have to shake His hand. It's called the hand of God. You have to understand the working of God's hand. As Amos chapter 3 verse 3 says, can two walk together unless they are agreed? Normally after we shake hands, we begin to chat, and sometimes we can even go for a walk. Even if we will just know each other, we shake hands and we begin to chat and we begin to walk. It's a beginning of a relationship when we shake hands. The hand of God is just the beginning of your Christian walk with God, of the beginning of your relationship with God. And God will begin to show you His hand. Just like many of us, when we meet someone, you will not just simply ask them, who is your lover? You won't ask questions like that. That's just too intimate, you know? Or you wouldn't want to ask, can I have your bank account number? You won't suddenly ask questions like that. Because the person will be very surprised why you are asking such intimate questions. So normally you will ask the person where you work, what is your profession? And you may say, oh, I'm a lawyer, I'm a teacher, or I'm an engineer, you know, or I'm something, something. So similarly, when you first know God, you begin to shake His hand, God begin to manifest the power of His hand to you. His hand is able to save. His hand is able to deliver. His hand is able to bless. That's what God will show to you. He has a power to save you, to deliver you, and to bless you. That's called the hand of God. And the hand of God will begin to manifest victories and blessings upon your life. When you first come to know the Lord, you begin to experience victory over the defeat that you are facing. Suddenly victory begins to come. And suddenly blessings begin to come upon your life. There is God manifesting his hand to you. Like in Psalm 110 verse 1 says, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool." God will begin to manifest the power of his right hand. Right hand always talks about favor. It also talks about privilege and talks about blessing. God begins to manifest it to you. And Isaiah 59 verse 1 says, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, nor his ear heavy that it cannot hear." You see, God's hand is not shortened. As you pray to God, he will stretch up his hand to save, to deliver, and to bless. That is the hand of God. And you begin to see your circumstances change for the better. As you learn to pray in Jesus' name to God the Father, you will begin to see the circumstances will begin to change to your favor. God's hands will be upon your circumstances to deliver you. And you will turn circumstances around to your favor. Maybe your boss may not like what you do, and suddenly through prayer, suddenly the favor of God is upon him, touch his heart, and suddenly now he has favor upon you and the things that you do. That's how powerful prayer is. Prayer can move the hand of God to deliver you, to save you, and to turn circumstances to your favor. And in Matthew chapter 12 verse 10, "And behold, there was a man who had a withered hand, and they asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath, that they might accuse him? Then he said to them," Jesus said to them, "what man is there among you who has one sheep, and if it falls into the pit on the Sabbath, will not lay hold of it and leave it out? Of how much more value then is a man than a sheep? Therefore, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath." The Pharisees trying to catch Jesus, to accuse him of doing work, of doing miracles on the Sabbath day. And to them, according to the word of God, he's not supposed to do any work. But actually, that's not the word of God says. The God of God says you should not do your normal work. And here Jesus clarified it. "Therefore, it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath." You have to do good on the Sabbath. You see, that someone is injured on the Sabbath, then of course you would have to help someone to help him to do good on the Sabbath day. Verse 13, "Then he said to the man," the man with the withered hand, "stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and it was restored as whole as the other. Then the Pharisees went out and plotted against him how they might destroy him." Because Jesus did that wonderful miracle, doing good on the Sabbath day, the religious Pharisees was offended and plotted against Jesus. I want you to know, as a Christian, it's always better to obey God than men. It's always to obedient to the word of God than the laws of men if it's contrary or is against the laws or against the word of God. That is the hand of God manifesting, bringing salvation, deliverance, and blessing, doing miracles of healing. There's a power of God's hand. And in Romans chapter 10 verse 17, as you see the hand of God being made manifest in your life, what will happen to you? As in Romans chapter 10 verse 17, so then faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Your favor begins to grow as you see God's turning the circumstances around, as you see God bringing forth victories and blessings upon your life. Your favor begins to grow in your heart. Now, your faith grows as you see the hand of God. Your faith grows. And as in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. And you have that desire after seeing the hand of God, the moving, changing the circumstances, then you desire to follow the word of God. You begin to desire to seek God's kingdom and his righteousness as you begin to see the hand of God. My brothers and sisters, and all the viewers from the body of Christ and our friends, and your faith begins to grow. Even today, if you hear God's word, your heart may be touched by the word of God. Your heart may be ministered by the word of God. And you may be thinking to yourself, can Jesus turn my circumstances around? Maybe you are sick. Or maybe you may just be infected by COVID-19. And you're undergoing some treatment in a hospital. I want you to know, you can call on to Jesus and he will stretch up his hand to heal you and to deliver you from this sickness, from this illness, as you call upon his name. The Bible says those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. The word of God says, call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you do not know of. That you do not know that Jesus is the Son of God who came from heaven to earth. And he has the power to heal you, to deliver you from this virus, from whatever sickness that you may have. He will stretch up his hand to deliver you. Just by calling forth to his name. And I hope that you too will stretch up your hands as God already stretched up his hands towards you when he sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross for your sins. The Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world and loved you that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. John 3:16 is God stretching forth his hand to shake your hand so that you may know him, that you may grow to know him, and you may grow in your faith. You will experience his salvation, his deliverance, and his blessings upon your life. And I hope today you will open your heart to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. I hope you will open your heart to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Just a simple prayer, actually. God sees our heart, not so much the words we say. He knows what is in our heart. As long as it's said from your heart, a simple prayer, it's like you are searching for your hands to shake God's hand. You can just say, Lord Jesus, I acknowledge I'm a sinner today. And I know you came and you have stretched up your hands towards me. And I want to shake your hands today by believing in you, by accepting you as my Lord and Savior in my heart. Forgive me of all my sins and all my mistakes I've done in the past. Come into my heart and be my Savior and be my Lord. Guide me and lead me from this day forward. In your name, I pray. Amen. If you have prayed this prayer, you have shaken God's hand and Jesus will come into your heart. And by His Spirit, you will be born again. And now, not only you can know the hand of God, you can even move deeper and closer. Like in James chapter 4. In James chapter 4 verse 8 says, draw near to God and He will draw near to you. As you draw near to God, God will draw near to you. How close you want to know God, how deep you want to walk with God depends on us. Because God has already decided. You can come as close as you can. It's up to us. Whether you want to grow deeper to God or not, God has already made the decision to let you come as close as you can. So it's up to us to draw closer to Him. After you know the hand of God, you must now know the face of God. Not only you experience victory and blessings by knowing God's hand. Now something more important that God wants to do in your life is found in Psalm 27 and verse 8. When you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will see. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies. Do not deliver me to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have been risen against me. For such as breathe out violence. I would have lost heart unless I believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and He shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. The next, the you from God's hand, you must move closer. After you shake someone's hand, and after you know the person for a while, normally you will invite the person maybe for a dinner at your home or in a nice restaurant. And then you were able to talk to each other face to face. And now you are able to share things that is more intimate. Share things that is more closer to your heart. Because now you are at a dinner and you are talking to each other face to face. you are more comfortable to share more intimate things with your friend now, which you have known. Similarly with the Lord, as you know God's hand, you must draw deeper to behold His face. By beholding God's face, you begin to know Him more. As in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 says, "But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image, from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord." Now, to know the face of God, it means is to worship Him. You don't worship the hand, you worship the face of God. And His hand will move on your behalf. As you worship the Lord, you will learn to wait upon Him. You will learn to spend more time or allocate more time to be in God's presence, to learn to wait upon God and to behold His face by worshiping Him, like what we did just now. And that many years ago, I learned this song of wonderful worship as I learned to know the face of God. This song goes, "I worship Him, O mighty God. There is none like You. I worship You, O Prince of Peace. There is what I want to do. I give You praise, for You are my righteousness, my righteousness. I worship You, O mighty God. There is none like You." You will learn to lift up your hands. You will learn to close your eyes, to focus upon God and to worship Him. And Jesus said, those who worship the Father must worship in spirit and in truth. Not just worship Him from our lips, but our heart is far away from Him. Neither we worship from our mind, but our emotions is somewhere else. But we begin to worship God from the depths of our heart. And Jesus said, in spirit and in truth. That's how we worship God. The Bible says the Father looks for such worshipers. As you begin to learn to worship God from your heart, not only you look for God, God begins to look for you. Because God sees our heart of worship. True worship is worship from our heart, not just from our lips. Not just saying words and singing songs. It is worshiping God from the depth of our heart. And it takes time to learn to wait upon God, to learn to settle our mind and to cast away our cares, and be able to worship God with a certain focus, with a certain depth of our heart of worship, because of our cares, and allow our heart to settle as we worship God. It's not something we do religiously. is something we do from our heart. The heart of worship is how we begin to know the face of God. As we begin to behold the face of God to worship, something very important has happened to us. Something very significant happened to us. Our heart, our soul, our emotions, even our mind are being transformed. As we worship God, our hearts and soul will begin to be transformed. God don't change us. God transform us from glory unto glory, from faith to faith, from victory upon victory. Change is very simple. You don't like your clothes, you just change your clothes. It can be very instant. You don't like Maggie Mee, you can just change to Cha Kway Teow and reorder. But transformation of heart takes time. So it takes time in worship to behold the face of God and begin to know the face of God. You begin to know Him. He is a good God. He is a merciful God. And He is a compassionate God. As you know God by beholding His face, something else also happened to you. As your heart and the soul are being transformed, your desires are changed. Your desires are changed. I was a businessman before I accepted the call of God upon my life. I was very much into business. I was very much into business. And business, something that I loved to do at that time. Closing business deals and traveling to overseas in Hong Kong, in Taipei, even in China at the time when it was still closed. Before 1997, very much I was into business. That was something I loved to do. And everything changed. And I was a Christian then. I know the hand of God. God bring blessings upon my life. Of course, one day in 1991, in our church retreat in Fraser's Hill in 1991, January. And I was worshiping God like everyone else in that retreat in Fraser's Hill in 1991. I was worshiping God. As I'm worshiping God, closing my eyes, and I begin to see Jesus with two angels walking towards me from afar. He begins to walk closer and closer. You ask me, how can I see? My eyes is closed, but I can see. And I realize if God wants you to see something, even you close your eyes, you will still see. My eye was shut, and yet I can see Jesus walking closer and closer. As you walk closer to me, especially, I'm maybe like 10 feet away. I begin, my leg becomes weak, my knees become weak, I just kneel down, and then the tears begin to roll down my face. Because before then, I've been always telling the Lord, I will do anything for the church, but please don't call me to be a pastor, something which I do not know how to do. Business, I know, but pastor, I do not know. Please don't call me to be a pastor. I've been saying to the Lord very often about that. But as I kneeled down before, and he walked closer to me, and he began to lay his right hand upon my head. And he just said these words. Three words, very clear and distinct, spoken to my heart, as if he was just standing. In fact, he's just standing there. He's laying hands, and he just said, "I call you." That's all. He just said, "I call you." That very instant, I know what he meant. He meant, "I call you to the full-time ministry. I call you to be my servant." I know what he meant. I just understood it. And he just turned and walked away. I never say much. He just turned. As quickly as he come, as quickly as he go. And that's why today I'm here sharing God's word to you, because of the vision I saw, because of God's call upon my life. It's not something I desire. It's good some people, they desire to be a pastor, but not me. I desire to do business. And that time business was doing pretty well. And I really do not want to be a pastor at that time. Of course, everything else changed since then. And I'm happy to be God's servant today. Let you know that I'm happy and humble to be God's servant. It's something that I cannot do on my own. It is by His grace and by His calling. I did not choose to be a pastor. I was chosen by Him. And I just humbly obey. And here I am today sharing to you the word of God. And I hope you hearken to His word. Because Jesus said He is coming again. Even today in the Christian religious calendar, we call it Palm Sunday, where Jesus entered Jerusalem riding on the donkey, and people begin to cry out to Him, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Son of David." A few days later, they crucify Him. And on the third day, on Easter Sunday, He rose again from the dead. And He said, "He is coming again." And the circumstances of this world that we are seeing right now, or the plagues of this virus, it has been spoken by the Lord Himself. In the last days, there will be famine and earthquakes and pestilence or plague upon the earth. It's the last days, and it's the beginning of sorrows before His coming. But Jesus ask us, be strong and be of good courage, because God is for us. Who can be against us? This behind this last days before the coming of the Lord. In fact, the next great biblical event that will happen is called the rapture of the church. We, the church, the bride of Christ, will be raptured before God's judgment, more severe than this virus, will fall upon this world. By the grace of God, we will be raptured by them. And if you are a Christian, listening to the word of God today, maybe you have not been going to church for a long time, and somehow you got this link, and somehow you're tuning into this channel, I want you to know God is speaking to you. It's time for you to come back to the Lord. But you may say, I have made horrible mistakes. I have made great error or sins in my life. I want you to know God is merciful and He's gracious. Just come back to the Lord and He will forgive you. And you will always and can always have a new beginning and to move forward and do not think of the past, but to move forward with the Lord. Once again, call the Christian brothers and join them in fellowship. Of course, for those of you who have not known the Lord Jesus Christ, I want you to know now is the time. There's not much time to waste. The Bible says, if you hear God's word, today, if you hear my word, do not harden your heart. Do not make excuses. Maybe another day or another time. Today you hear God's word. It's the day God's grace has come upon you. It's the day you must open your heart to receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. This reminds me the same word I spoken to a man which I love so dearly. And this man did not know the Lord before. And for almost 50 years of his life, he was involved in other religious belief. He was involved in trance, the spirit comes upon him. He was involved in fortune telling. And he is even like a priest in the temple, he's able to fortune tell the messages, you know, that they pray to the idols, certain scriptures, able to even to explain to those people, those devotees. But that morning, when I told him, you have no more time left. You must believe in Jesus today, because today you hear God's word. Today His grace is upon you, not yesterday, not tomorrow. And joy fills my heart when He say in our own dialect in Hokkien, Hola, Hola, Kiajin Wasyong Sin, meaning to say, okay, okay, today I will believe. I am able to lead him to the Lord. And that wonderful person is my father. And I'm so thankful to God. Even though he passed away at the age of 68, he is in heaven together with my mother. And one day I will see them again. We're going to have a wonderful reunion. The one person that I love dearly, and I'm close, of course, I love my mom as well, very much as well, is my father. Because he always spent the time, even as a trishaw peddler, he always spent the time to be with us before he go out on his trishaw every morning. And many times at night, he will come back with fruits, with durian, tasty durian, and wake us up at 11 p.m. at night to eat the durian. And he has fetched many passengers. He has a good income that day. He will buy special food for us. And he taught me many things as a father. And I'm happy that he received Jesus and God's grace comes upon him. And I hope you too will receive Jesus Christ when the grace of God comes upon you today. at this moment by saying the prayer. Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Be my Savior and be my Lord. Lead me and guide me from this day forward. In your precious name, I pray. Amen. And I hope you tell your friends, your Christian friends, give them a call. They will be delighted. In fact, Bible says that angels rejoice in heaven. And you open your heart to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And your name will be written in the book of life. God has a book of life, and your name will be written there. You can rejoice. And you will have a place reserved for you in heaven. In fact, Jesus said, I go away to prepare a place for you. And when he comes, he will take us there. He will take you there to the place where he has prepared for you. Church and my brothers and sisters in the Lord, in the body of Christ, and all our friends and viewers today. And I know that you are blessed by God's word today. And I know that God has spoken to you. As we behold his face, you will begin to surrender our life to him. And we will desire to walk with him and do his will. And that desire will lead us to the heart of God. And I will close with this. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7 says, But the Lord said to Samuel, Do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refuse him, for the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And in Acts 13 verse 22 says, And when he had removed him, he raised up for them David as king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, who will do all my will. By beholding the face of God, you will begin to move deeper to the heart of God. And God will begin to share his perfect will for you. When God will begin to share his secrets with you as you move into the heart of God. Because God knows that you will desire and you will obey. And as you know his will, that you will do his will. That's why King David did say, as a man after God's own heart, who will do all his will. When you know the heart of God, you will desire to do his will and have a deeper walk with him. In conclusion, when you move into the heart of God, your journey of faith will begin to meet your path of destiny. It's where your destiny takes over. Your journey of faith, and you begin to walk in the destiny God has for your life, and you begin to really understand why you're on this earth, and you begin to understand why you cannot be satisfied with the things of the world or even with the pleasures of the world. There's always something missing in your heart. That something is God's perfect will for you, God's destiny, that you need to walk in it, the path of your destiny. And especially those who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, you will have that vacuum in you. No matter how rich, how comfortable, how luxurious your life may be, or may seems to be, you will always have that vacuum. And that vacuum can only be filled by God, by your Savior. And He will lead you from His hand to His face and to His heart. It's where your journey of faith will meet the path of your destiny. And you will have, and you'll begin to understand what it means to walk in destiny, to walk in the fulfillment of your life. True fulfillment of your life is to walk with God in the destiny He has given to you. And church, I want to thank all of you for watching and hearing. And I hope you will respond to God's word today by drawing closer to Him. And take this time, where they have the movement control order until April 14, that we have to stay home. Don't just stay home and watch TV. And don't just stay home and stay fat by eating a lot. But stay home. Stay in prayer, stay in God's presence, stay in worship, and behold His face in spirit and in truth, that you may draw closer into His heart, that you will know Him. Eternal life is knowing God, not His only His hand, not only His face, not His heart. When you know God's heart, now you can walk with God. Now you can have a deeper walk with God when you know the heart of God. Shall we pray right now as we close our eyes and pray? Father, we thank You for Your word today. Thank You for Your word that touches our heart. Father, especially those who have said the sinner's prayer today after listening to Your word. Father, You stretch up Your hands to save them, to deliver them, and to bless them, that they will learn to draw closer to You in time to come, to behold Your face and to know Your heart. Bless the Lord Your church, Full Gospel Christian Church International, FGCCI. Bless, Lord, all Your pastors, Your leaders, Lord, and all Your chosen people, that Your name will be greatly magnified and glorified through Your church. And at this time, when the world is experiencing darkness, Lord, let Your church will arise and shine. As the word says in Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1 and 3. Arise and shine, for Your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. When darkness fills the earth and deep darkness the people, but the Lord's glory has risen upon us. Church, let us arise and shine for the glory of the Lord by sharing the gospel of salvation, those who are yet to know Him, and to bring back those who have gone astray to the path of righteousness again. Father, we thank You for Your word today. We give You back all the glory and honor and praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, church, for your faithfulness and your great support, and for tuning in and focusing upon the message. And I know that the Lord has blessed your heart. I just sense in my heart some of you need some prayer, some ministry. I'm going to stretch out my hands, and I want you to close your eyes. And for those that say the sinner's pray according. You have just said a prayer for the first time to receive Jesus as the Lord and Savior. I want to pray special blessings for you even right now. As you close your eyes and focus upon the prayer. Father, I thank you for all those who have said this prayer, seen this prayer today. Bless them, O Lord. Let your word, O Lord, will be still in the depths of my heart. Lord, let the enemy will not steal your word from their heart, but the word, Lord, will grow deep and be rooted in your hearts, and it will in time bear fruit, so Father God. In time, Lord, it will grow, Lord, to become mature Christians and disciples. And Lord, that you will lead them, O God, to a Bible-believing church, O God, O Lord, for fellowship and for ministry and for growth. Bless them, O Father God, and deliver them, Father God, for whatever situations they be in. And those who may be sick, O Father God, let the healing power will flow to them. And even those, O God, who are infected by this COVID-19 virus, I pray in Jesus' mighty name, let the healing power will flow to them. In the mighty name of Jesus, I rebuke that virus. I command you to be withered from your roots and depart from their body right now. Depart from their body right now. Be withered from your roots. And do not enter any cell in the mighty name of Jesus. But vanish from their body and return where you come from. And let the healing power of God flow to your body right now. And those who need ministry and healing, let the healing power of God flow to you right now from the crown of the head right to the soles of your feet. And let the blessings of the Lord flow upon you. And may the Lord restore back what you have lost. And may the Lord restore back your health. And may the Lord restore back the blessings. And may the Lord look upon you with favor and deliver you and cause you to stand upon the rock. And the eyes upon the Lord be upon you. Let the hand upon of the Lord of deliverance and favor and blessings be upon you now and forevermore in Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Jesus.